I am really happy to be back here. Now for three reasons, as the rector have said, tonight to give a lecture on... Hello. Tonight to give a lecture on the psychology of time perspective, yes. The topic of my lecture will be the secret power of time, surviving and thriving in a timely fashion. But tomorrow I give a lecture at the Warsaw School of Social Psychology and Humanities on my journey from evil to heroism, similar to what I gave last year, but it will include many new elements. But as the rector said, the third reason I'm excited to be here is today to work with many people who are collaborating to do something unique in the world, to create a wonderful center for youth, the Nikki Ceviche, to come after school and on Saturday, to help transform their life and make them social change agents who will make their families better, their community better. And we think it will be a model for small cities throughout Poland. We hope, the commercial is, we need some of your talent to bring your talent there to work with Waldemar and Anna Basha, who are on the ground agents. And also we need some funding. I gave a little money, my publisher PWN will give some money, director at Warsaw School of Social Psychology will give some money. But to make this work, we need a lot of money, but mostly a lot of talent. End of commercial, start of my lecture. So, it's simply about time. I work a little Polish element in. And so, we're gonna have fun as well as exchange ideas. Hello. Louder. We need a better connection between you and me in this sound studio, because the volume on a lot of the videos varies. So if I go like this, louder, like this, low, like this, okay. It's too low. What is the Polish word for louder? Hello? Would you take the highroad if you could choose? Do you believe you're a victim of the compromise? 'Cause I believe you change your mind. Paradox says, I think the most important influence on all of your decisions and your everyday actions is inside of you. And yet you are unaware of your personal psychology of time perspective. So that's a paradox. How could it be something that has such a big influence on you that you don't know you have? It's in your mind, it's in your brain, it's in the way you think about life. So that is what we're going to do today, try to resolve that time paradox.
Right, start the clock, please. 30 seconds, studio. Keep it quiet, please. Settle down. It's about time. End sequence. Take one. 15 seconds, studio. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
So I want to begin in an unusual place for a psychology lecture. I want to go back to the Garden of Eden and the famous temptation myth by the German artist Lucas Cranach. And in this myth, Eve is seen as tempting Adam to take a bite of the forbidden fruit. Because the serpent, as you see in the middle, first tempted Eve to do it, and now she is going to try to tempt Adam to eat the forbidden fruit. So let's tune in to imagine the discussion between the three of them. So Eve says to Adam, "Come on, Adam, don't be afraid. I did it. You should take a bite of this delicious forbidden fruit. It's really yummy. Take a bite, babe, you deserve it. Remember, you are God's perfect creation." And the serpent says, "One bite, Adam, don't abandon Eve. You are the man, you are the only man. Don't be such a..." "Be a man." And Adam says, he's in trouble. He says, "I don't know, we might get in trouble with God." She says, "Come on, Adam, do it for me. I don't know. Okay, maybe just one bite. One small bite. What the hell? What could happen?" With that small bite, he loses paradise. And interestingly, that story is a myth, of course. The myth is about what happens if you do not blindly obey authority. You could be God's perfect creature, and if you make a small mistake, give in to temptation, you could lose paradise. It is the same myth as the Lucifer effect myth. Lucifer was God's favorite angel. Lucifer means the bearer of light. And one day God created, he said, "I want all angels to honor my perfect creature, Adam." Lucifer, Beelzebub, Mammon said, "God, it doesn't make sense. We are angels. He is a mere mortal, even if you created him, and we existed prior to him. He should honor us." And God said, "I'm sorry, you have just committed two sins, the sin of pride and the sin of disobedience to authority. And therefore, he's going to get Michael, the Catholic hitman, Catholic mafia man, to battle the evil angels." And with that, of course, Michael wins and Lucifer loses. And paradoxically, God creates hell as a place to put the fallen angels. But what is the message? The message is, if you disobey God, you lose. It doesn't matter if you're God's perfect creature or you're God's favorite angel, you go to hell. Who made up the story? No one could have been there. It's not like the Gospel of St. John, Paul, Luke. These are myths made up by men, rabbis, priests, teachers, to tell us all you must blindly obey authority or else the consequences are terrible. And this is something that in my other lecture I oppose. I say you must obey righteous authority and you must defy, rebel against unjust authority. And a lot of authority is unjust. A lot of the authority that your parents were forced to obey for many, many years was unjust. And if any authority like that exists, we want to train young people to rebel and resist. So life is temptation, yielding, resisting, yes, no, now, later, impulsive, reflective, present focus, and future focus. So psychologists now are beginning to try to understand how some people are able to resist temptation and other people are not. In fact, it's really what you mean by willpower. Okay? Willpower is somehow the inner ability to resist temptation when it's so easy to give in to temptation. Some years ago at Stanford University, my colleague, Walter Mischel, did an unusual experiment, very simple one. He played a game with some children who are 4 years old, and if they won the game, he gave them a marshmallow, which they liked as a treat. But he tells the children, you could have the marshmallow now. I have to go out. If you wait till I come back, you could have two. If you like a marshmallow, it makes sense to wait to have two. And he left the room and they observed some children could wait, some children could not wait. And that simple decision, turns out, has profound effects on their entire life. I repeated that demonstration recently in San Francisco with little four-year-old children, and I want to share with you something very lovely. What is it that the children do when they are faced with this temptation? Oh, please. Okay. Come in and have a seat here. Okay. Sit right up. Okay. Now, I'm going to play a game with you, and I would like you to point to which one is the correct answer. Which one is happy most of the time, the shy one or the not shy one? Not shy one, correct. Which one has a brown nose? The shy puppet or the not shy puppet?
The not shy puppet.
Point there. Thank you. I'm sorry, stop that. Which one is happy most of the time? The shy one or the not shy one?
Probably
the
happy.
Thank you. That's wonderful. I want to give you a prize for having done so well. Do you like marshmallows? You do? Well, here's a marshmallow for you. You can eat it now, but if you wait until I come back, you can have two of them. So you can eat this now, but I'm going to go outside for a minute. When I come back, you can have two marshmallows if you wait.
Okay, I'll wait.
Do you think you can wait? Okay, we'll see. I'll be back in a minute. Wants that marshmallow. Hello. You waited for me. Okay, so now you know what's going to happen. You're going to get a double treat. I'm going to give you two of these. Lovely marshmallows. You want to eat them now or save them for later? Okay, well, go ahead. A little sticky.
I've had marshmallows before.
While some children waited, others just ate it. So I'm going to give you a prize. I'm going to give you a treat. The treat is a delicious marshmallow. But if you wait, I have to go check my car. When I come back, if you wait, you can have two of them. You can have one now, or when I come back, you can have two. Okay? Okay. So this is temptation in action. And she lost. One more bite, all gone. Hello, my dear. You ate the marshmallow. Was it delicious?
But she only got one.
Do you like marshmallows?
No.
You don't like marshmallows?
I was ready.
You like chocolate?
Yes, okay. I love chocolate.
The treat you have won is a chocolate. But, if you wait till I come back, you could get two. You could eat this now. I have to go check my car. When I come back, if you wait, I'll give you two of them.
I said twice.
So you can eat it now, but if you wait till I come back, you have two.
Three times.
Okay. You think you can wait? So I'm gonna be back in a few minutes. So you can eat it now, but if you wait, you're gonna have two.
Four times.
Okay, I'll be back.
I'm not even out of the door. But now you have to imagine, what will he say when I come back? How did he interpret the situation?
Hello, I'm back. How are you?
Good.
You ate the chocolate.
He said, I waited. I didn't leave the room. Give me two more. So you know he will be in trouble in life because he interprets things the way he wants to see rather than the way other people create the world for him. So the question is, what difference does it make if you give it with that simple decision? Well, my colleague Walter Mischel went back 14 years later when those children were finishing high school or going to college, and now he's gone back 40 years later when they are adults to understand that simple decision, which is really a decision to be impulsive, live in the present moment, or really to be future-oriented, to think of the consequences of your action. And so here's a little cartoon we made that illustrates that difference 14 years later.
Be familiar with the famous marshmallow study conducted by my colleague psychologist Walter Mischel, in which a group of four-year-olds were given one marshmallow and told they were allowed to eat it immediately. They were told that if they could wait to eat the marshmallow after being left alone with it for a while, then they would be given an extra marshmallow to eat. Most eat the marshmallow as soon as they are left alone with it, but some other children are able to resist temptation. Those children who ate the marshmallow right away are considered to be oriented toward the present, while those who resisted temptation have an orientation toward the future. When the children were interviewed years later as 18-year-olds, there were amazing differences between the children who were able to delay gratification and those children who couldn't resist the immediate temptation. Scored 250 points higher on the SAT, overreacts to frustration, works well under pressure, indecisive, self-reliant and confident, prone to jealousy and envy. The marshmallow experiment is a classic study of how a person's ability to delay gratification, even at the age of four, can predict many significant future outcomes. But what does this have to do with you? A lot. In my new book, The Time Paradox, you'll learn how your own relationship to time plays a significant role in your personal happiness. Whether you're looking for a better understanding of the world at large, from religion to politics to business to national destinies, or want a deeper understanding of yourself, The Time Paradox teaches you how to recognize your own attitudes toward time and how your everyday decisions are influenced by your personal time orientation. And it will help you overcome the hidden mental biases that keep you too attached to the past, unhealthily obsessed with future goals, or too focused on immediate gratification. You can improve your personal success, happiness, and psychological health. The Time Paradox will show you how. It's only a matter of time, making time work for you.
So, the message to parents and teachers is that among the most important lessons you can teach your children is learn to delay gratification, learn to say no or later to temptation, and of course, teach children that every action they take has future consequences that they should learn to anticipate and take the ones that they imagine will lead to positive consequences and avoid the ones that might lead to negative consequences. So what is time perspective? It's really the study of how individuals, all of us,
divide the flow of our personal human experience into different time frames or time zones. We do it automatically and non-consciously. And these time frames vary between people in different cultures, people in different social classes, from different nations, and people from different climates, geography. But the problem is they become biased. By bias, I mean we overuse some of them and we underuse other ones. And what I'm going to propose today, the solution is, how do we teach people, all of us, to achieve a balanced time perspective? What is a balanced time perspective? Stay tuned, I will tell you in a few minutes. So the model is, you have to make a decision. On the basis of that decision, you're going to take an action. So for every student, the constant decision is, should I study alone, or should I go and have fun with my friends? But these decisions are over and over. You're somebody who has diabetes. Should I eat this delicious sugar fruit or not? So we make many, many decisions, little ones and big ones. For some people, the main influence on that decision are things in the immediate stimulus situation. Okay, what does that mean? What it looks like, what it smells like, what are other people doing in that setting? What is your biology, physiology telling you? And so for those people, their decision is really like that little boy. We call them present-oriented type of people. For other people making the same exact decisions, they ignore the present, and they begin by saying, when was I in a situation like this in the past? They search their memory. What did I do? Did it work? I will do again. Did it not work? I might do something differently. We're going to call them past-oriented. A third group of people doesn't focus on the present, doesn't focus on the past. They focus on anticipating the future consequences. If I do this, what happens? Good. If I do this, what could happen? Bad. We're going to call those people future-oriented. So these are our three main types, but we're going to divide them up in a moment. People who are future and past-oriented, that's an abstraction. There is no future, there is no past, except in our mind that we create it. There is a present. A present is an empirical reality. But although I'm talking about this as if they were types of people, it's really a degree. The scale I will describe in a moment measures the degree to which people have each of these different time perspectives. So in the book, The Time Paradox, I hope I will be signing books afterwards upstairs. And if you can take the scale in the book, or you can go online if you can't afford the book, thetimeparadox.com. So there are six time factors that we have identified. I've been doing this research for more than 20 years. There are two ways to focus on the past. One way is you think of the good times, the success in life, your happy birthdays, the family tradition at Christmas or Easter, your best friends. For other people, when they think of the past, they only think of negatives, regret, failure, all the things you did not accomplish. There are two ways to focus on the present. One is, of course, present hedonism, like that little boy. You do things impulsively. You enjoy friends, family, food, good times, and of course, good sex. The other way is to be present oriented is to be present fatalist, to say, nothing I do makes a difference, so why try? And also, in some religions, like Muslim religion, you believe your life is fated by Allah, that you don't make decisions. Everything you do is preordained by Allah. There's two ways to be focused on the future. The one obvious one, which most of us share, is your life is oriented around goals. You set a goal, this is what I want to achieve, here's the means by which I will try to achieve that. But again, there are some people who believe a different kind of future. We call it transcendental future, that life really begins after the death of the mortal body. So you live your life so that when you die, you will go to heaven rather than hell. And again, this is many Catholics and Hindus and others. Interestingly, Jews do not believe in another life, an alternative life. So on this scale, they would form a score very, very low. So as I said, many things influence your time perspective, your geography, climate. If you live in a tropic zone where The environment never changes. It's always wonderful. You don't develop alternative ways of thinking about time, culture, religion. Okay, we will say in a moment. Protestants are much more future oriented than Catholics everywhere. Social class. You become middle class by being future oriented. You stay poor by being present oriented. The main thing education does is it gets present-oriented children to become more and more future-oriented. If you grow up in a family or in a culture where there's political or economic instability, then you never learn to trust. Trust in your parents, trust in your government, and to be future-oriented, you have to trust. So in the demonstration with the children... So the pace of life is slower in countries that do not have modern technology. One of the functions of modern technology is give us a fast pace of life. Interestingly, in Japanese culture in the past, in every family, fathers lived totally in the future. Japanese men took shortest vacations, worked harder than any other country, including America, and many of the Japanese women were trained to preserve the past. To do a tea ceremony that takes several hours to make a cup of tea because they make it exactly the way it was made hundreds of years ago. And the children were really forced to go because it was important for the children to succeed. After school, they went to evening school and school on Saturday called Juku school. And now, interestingly, the children in Japan are like American hippies from the 1960s. They don't want to go to school. They want to shop till they drop. They don't focus on their future. They want to live for the present moment. In America, in the 60s, children could leave. They all came to San Francisco. But in Japan, you can't leave. There's no place to go. So it's interesting culture clash that I hope some anthropologists are studying. In Sicily, where my family comes from, and I just came from there, past traditions combined with present orientation and no focus on the future. So I visit every year. I have a foundation there. We award scholarships to students. We create computer labs. So this is a picture of the grandmother making a little pot of sauce, pasta sauce. Maybe takes several days. And the family will eat it in 10 minutes. But it doesn't matter because food is a way to show your love. So I developed over many years a scale called Zimbardo Time Perspective Inventory that has 56 items, but we also have 15 item short version. And now we have tested this in 22 different nations, and we have a scale that is universal. 36 items that work in 22 different nations around the world. So, when you make a scale, so we take a little detour, a little statistical detour. When you do a scale, the important thing is, does it predict to anything else? What is it correlated with? So after I developed a scale, we give it to hundreds of students, and in addition to that scale, we give many, many other well-known scales. And we see what is the correlation between being high on future orientation and many other scales, high on present hedonism, many other scales. In personality psychology throughout the world, when you correlate any two personality measures, the typical correlation is 0.2 or 0.3. Zero means no effect, plus one is perfect. So most scales predict to a low level. The thing that is amazing that I will show you is our scale correlates higher than almost any other scale within all of psychology. Our correlations are on the order of 60 and 70 and even higher. So let's do a little tour. If you are high on future orientation, your highest correlation is being conscientious, 0.7. Conscientious means you follow on what you promise. People can depend on your word. You prefer consistency, correlation 0.6. You have control over your ego, you have high energy, and you control your impulse. What is negative is you don't seek sensation, you're low on aggression and low on depression. So this is this could be very good. And we did this with 205 students, older students in America. So these are the people, like the little girl, like the first little girl. I am able to resist temptation when I know there is work to be done. The importance of conscientiousness is this. In 2008, there was an investigation from meta-analysis, 20 different independent studies with 9,000 people, 6 different nations, and they used many different measures of conscientiousness. What they found is the people who are more conscientious live 2 years longer at every age. It is the only psychological measure that predicts mortality. Now, it's not mystical. We now know if you're future-oriented, you exercise more, you get health checkups. If you're women, you get pap smears. You eat good food. You wear seat belts. You don't take risks. You don't do dangerous things. So if you're future-oriented, you arrange your life to be more healthy, and you arrange your life not to take negative risks, and that's why you live 2 years longer. If you pass positive, you're happy, you have good self-esteem, you're friendly, a little bit of energy, you're not anxious, you're not depressed, and you're not aggressive. Now, so imagine you have 5 students sitting side by side. Same grade, same average, same school. So now here's the third one who's present hedonistic. I think like that little boy with the skull. Novelty seeking, sensation seeking, 0.7. The whole life is organized around avoiding boredom, seeking novelty. A lot of energy, some aggression, but interestingly, this is really the center of creativity. Because these are people who don't want the old. So they always think out of the box. They're never in a box. The problem is they have no control over their ego, minus 75. There is no correlation in psychology higher than this. If I measure your intelligence, 2 weeks later, you get 0.71. They don't care about consistency, no impulse control, low on conscientiousness, low on emotional stability. So these are people who you want to invite to your party. They're going to be fun, they're going to be friendly. You want to have one of them in your business because they could be very creative. These are more likely to be jazz musicians than classical musicians, and interesting people. But, as you'll see in a moment, this is a recipe for addiction. So I do things impulsively, making decisions on the spur of the moment. Now we have 2 time categories which are sad for me and dangerous. If you are high on present fatalism, your highest traits of all are aggression, anxiety, and depression, 0.4, 0.5. But minus 7, you don't care about the future consequences of your behavior. The more present fatalistic you are, the less you care about what happens when you do something. You don't have enough ego control, low self-esteem, low conscientious, and you're not happy. So this is very sad. Now these are college students functioning. This is typical of poor people, of immigrants, but these are middle class college students who have this profile. Equally sad, and maybe even worse, if you are past negative, your dominant trait is anxiety, 0.75. Next, depression, 0.7. Next, aggression, 0.6. That is a killer triad, okay? And low self-esteem, low emotional stability, no impulse control, low happy, low energy. Now, what does this mean if we stop there? This means that really we should be giving our children at all levels this scale, and children have this profile, they need help. They need remedial help before things get bad. Now, this also means that if these children face frustration or stress or are threatened, they are the ones who are likely to become high school shooters, These are the ones who are likely to be aggressive, or these are the ones who are likely to commit suicide. So I call them at-risk time perspective. High past negative, high present fatalism. Now, what I have not included, I'm sure some of you are thinking about, what about people who live in the moment? So this is the Zen holistic expanded present. Not hedonistic, not fatalistic, but again, the whole notion of meditation, the whole notion of Zen, is to be able to try to live in the moment, not focus on the future, not focus on the past. In the Sanskrit it is written, yesterday is already a dream, and tomorrow but a vision. But today, well lived, makes every yesterday a dream of happiness, and every tomorrow a vision of hope. So this is really a wonderful orientation. And Buddha tells us, do not dwell on the past, do not dream of the future. Concentrate the mind on the present moment. So this, again, is something we all do. Anyone who takes a course in meditation, which we don't need a course, but we all need to meditate more to reduce the stress of being future-oriented. So Don Corleone said, don't take my offer, you can't refuse. Most of us are here because we're future-oriented. Many are workaholic. So we have to learn how to get into the flow of chosen present hedonism. The problem with present hedonists, it's not chosen, it's what they are. So we have to learn to live in the moment. We have the art of now. We have to stop watching the clock. We have to tune into our inner timer. We have to spend more time with nature, because nature is endless. It's not future, it's not past, it's not present. We have to meditate stress away, concentrate the focus of the moment on each breath, and we call it expanding the present holistic moment. So let's review what I've said up to now and point ahead. I gave a lecture like this a few years ago in London, and the person listening to the lecture took 10 minutes of my talk, gave it to three artists, and told them to illustrate every concept. And what they did is really remarkable, because you're going to hear me repeat some of what I said, plus some new things, but throughout you see a hand making the drawing. And many of the drawings are more creative than I could have imagined, certainly more creative than I am. So this is a good way we review, and then after this we go on to talk about many new things. Royal Society of Art.
So what we have discovered in 30 years of research, there's six main time zones that people live in. Two focus on the past, two on the present, and two on the future. The people who focus on the past either remember all the good old times, successes, happy birthdays, nostalgia. These are the people who keep the family record, the family books, who have the family rituals. There are other people who focus only on regret, only on failure, only on all the things that went wrong. So we call those focus past positive or past negative. There are two ways to be present oriented. The most obvious is to be hedonistic, that you live for pleasure and you avoid pain. You seek novelty, you seek sensation. There are other people who are present-oriented because they say, it doesn't pay to plan. My life is fated. Fated by my religion, fated by my poverty, fated by the conditions that I'm living under. Most of us are here because we are future-oriented, that we have learned to work rather than play, to resist temptation. But there's another way to be future-oriented. Depending on your religion, life begins after the death of the mortal body. To be future-oriented, you have to trust that when you make a decision about the future, it's going to carry out. If you have great inflation, you don't put money in a bank because you can't trust the future. If there's instability in your family, adults can't keep their promises to you. The closer you are to the equator, the more present-oriented you are. The more you're in an environment where climate doesn't change, it gives you a set of imagining sameness rather than change. Protestants everywhere have higher gross national product than Catholic countries, in part because of the Protestant ethic, because of the notion that you work hard to succeed to demonstrate that you are God's chosen people. My family comes from Sicily, and in Italy there is a political movement called La Liga to cut Italy in half, to have North Italy and South Italy,
kind of just below Tuscany. The people in the north say, we do all the work. The people in the south are lazy, they're like children, they want to have babies, have 3-hour dinners, etc. People in the south say, they're not Italian, they're German and Austrian, you know. They eat yogurt instead of pasta. They take their lunch in a paper bag. And in the recent election, the Liga got 14% of the national vote. It turns out, it is accurate. We've done research to say people in the north tend to be, on a scale, much more future-oriented. People in the south tend to be more past-oriented or present hedonistic. And so my family is Sicilian, and I come from Sicily. I go back every year. I start an educational foundation. We send high school kids to college and set up computer labs. And I'm talking about some of this stuff, and a man comes up and says, I'm a poet. I live with words. And it wasn't until I heard your talk that I realized there's no future tense verb in Sicilian dialect. I said, what do you mean? There was, is, there's no will be. He said, that's why nothing gets done. And I didn't realize it because we never plan. So again, here's how when you have a number of people who share a certain time perspective, then it does come to characterize the nation. The same way, if you have a Catholic nation where people tend to be present or past-oriented, rather than a Protestant nation where in general people tend to be more future-oriented, it affects you in very profound ways. So there's a wonderful book called The Geography of Time, and it's written by a dear friend of mine, Robert Levine, who's a social psychologist, and he actually literally went around the world doing wonderful experiments. He looks at what he calls the pace of life. See, time perspective is how people divide their own experience into partitions, time zone. Another kind of time orientation is your sense of duration. How much time has expired while you're sitting in a dentist's office before they start drilling? How much time has expired when you've been waiting in line? How much time has expired when you're having fun or at set? So time duration is totally a function of whether you're bored, whether you're excited or not. And what he does is he shows that in different cultures, people have a different pace of life. And you do this very simply. You sit in a cafe and you mark off 100 meters, and as people pass, you start a stopwatch. And you see how fast people walk. You go to a post office, and on a piece of paper you say, I'd like, you know, 3 pounds of this postage or 10 euros. And you see how long it takes. So he has a bunch of these measures. And it turns out you can identify cultures as different pace of life, and now cities. And he shows in America, you can rank 60 cities according high pace of life and low pace of life. And the ones that have the highest pace of life, men have the most coronary problems. That is, this becomes part of your whole way of life. We all begin life as present hedonists. All of us. I mean, at the breast, at the bottle, we want pleasure, we want to avoid pain. And one of the things that families do, and especially school, my sense is the purpose of schooling is to take present-oriented little beasts and make them more future-oriented, and some cultures make them more past-oriented. In America, a child drops out of school every 9 seconds. This is worse for kids from a minority background, and it's worse for boys than girls. There's actually a disaster recipe developing among boys in America, literally dropping out of high school, college, and it's not simply poor performance. One of the problems is, a recent study shows that by the time a boy is 21, he has spent at least 10,000 hours playing video games alone. Probably more watching pornography alone. And you put that together, it means A, they haven't learned social skills, emotional social intelligence, but also it means that they live in a world that they create. They're playing Warcraft, they're playing these other games, which is exciting. In fact, I just heard the other day that these game companies are now going to develop 3D games so that the world will be all around you. Their brains are being digitally rewired, which means they will never fit in a traditional classroom, which is analog. Somebody talks at you without even the nice pictures, meaning it's boring. I mean, you control nothing. You sit there passively. And if you want to change the curriculum, I understand the traditionalists here say we got to go back to reading, writing, arithmetic. Disaster. These kids will never fit into that. They have to be in a situation where they are controlling something, and school is set up, you control nothing. You're passive. This school is all about learning delay of gratification, literally endlessly. All addictions are addictions of present hedonism. Food, sex, drugs, gambling, etc. All of our propaganda, all of our educational message, all our public relations messages are designed for future-oriented kids, who's not the problem. They tell you, here's the negative consequences of doing what you're doing. Future-oriented kids know that, and they don't do it. Present-oriented kids know the future consequences. If you're a teenage girl, you know that if you have unprotected sex, you're likely to get pregnant or have sexually transmitted disease. You know it, but that knowledge never feeds back to change your behavior. So that's the interesting thing about time perspective. I think we are underestimating the power of technology in rewiring young people's brains. Kids don't wear wristwatches. They say it's a single function device. You don't waste time with a single function device. And they live in a digital thing. What matters is the second. You know, I didn't mention one of the things that gets people upset in America is how long it takes to boot up your computer and how long it takes to download something. Less than a minute. That makes people angry. So it becomes an emotional thing. You get angry waiting in line, waiting for services. Waiting is a waste of time, even if it's waiting for your computer to boot up. So I think there's a fundamental change going on in our culture that I think we adults are not realizing, that kids are totally different than we were. And it's because it's revolution in time. There was a recent study we did with USA Today asking Americans how busy they are. The vast majority of Americans, more than 50%, said, I'm busier now than I was last year, busier last year than the previous year, and I sacrifice friends, family, and sleep for my success. This is across the board, not separating my future orientation. And then we say, suppose you had an eight day a week, what would you do? They say, oh, that would be great. They would spend that most of that time working hard, achieving more, not with friends, not with family, and not even sleeping. They did this study 20 years ago, and I was upset, again, from this Italian background. Only 60% of Americans said they have regular sit-down family dinners. When we redid the study last year, only 1 in 5 American families have sit-down dinners together. In America, we talk about family values. You can't have a family value if you never have family meals together. I think many of life's puzzles can be solved by simply understanding our own time perspective and that of others. Lots of conflict we have with people is really a conflict in different time perspectives. Once you're aware of that, you stop making negative attributions like you're dumb or you're childish or you're pig-headed or you're authoritarian. It's really the most simple idea in the world.
So the technique they're using is a special technique called Prezi, P-R-E-Z-I. Keynote that I'm using is from Macintosh. It's developed from PowerPoint. Keynote and Keynote and PowerPoint are really just digital advances of old-fashioned slides. Prezi is based on Google Map. You start with a whiteboard. So Prezi is really designed for visual artists, but anyone can do it. My friends, two Hungarian men created Prezi. One is in San Francisco, one in Budapest. And you should examine it. There's online, prezi.com. So with that commercial, we move on. So again, it's not enough to make a scale and correlate with other scales. We want to see, how does it influence actual behavior? So we do an experiment on solving mazes. We're going to have students from Stanford who are very smart. Half of them are going to be high on present orientation, half on future orientation. We're going to ask them to solve some mazes. We have an equal number of males and females, and we show them different mazes, like this one, like other ones, and then we see how long it takes to solve the maze. The interesting thing is, when we say begin, the people who are future-oriented don't move the pencil. They look. They look at the end, the goal, they look at the beginning, and they visually search the map. The people who are present-oriented, they're impulsive, they begin. And they get in the cul-de-sac, and they go back, and they get frustrated, and they quit. So even at a place like Stanford, where people are smart, if you're future-oriented, 90% solve the maze. But if you're present-oriented, only 60% solve the maze. That's a huge cognitive difference of 30%, highly significant. We redid the study at Berkeley University. And we took only future-oriented students, and we hypnotized half of them to say, you live in the present moment.
forget the past, forget the future, and we get the same exact result. Who smokes, takes drugs, drinks alcohol? You already know the answer, obviously. We did a big study of more than 1,000 students, half at Stanford, half at Cornell. Cornell is a famous, very high quality university on the East Coast in New York. We gave them measures of alcohol use and measures of risky driving, and we included males as well as females. Just very quickly, so the correlation at Stanford is the same as the correlation at Cornell of males. If you're present-oriented, high correlations in the order of 40s and 50s, drinking a lot, taking risky driving. If you're future-oriented, it's negative. The interesting thing is women are the same. So this is the first study that separated out males and females. If you're a present-oriented woman, you behave exactly like a present-oriented man. You drink too much, you binge drink, and you take risk driving in your car. Now we go to a mental hospital where heroin addicts are being in recovery, and we compare them to other people in the hospital who are not addictive. We give our scale, and what we show is heroin addicts are significantly more present hedonistic, significantly more present fatalistic, significantly less future-oriented, and no difference of the past. And those effects are greater than 0.01, could happen only 1 in 100 times by chance. Guess who takes risk? Now we go to high school. We give them various scales, and it turns out taking risk driving, if you're present-oriented, again, high correlation, driving while drunk. If you get caught driving while drunk, it costs your parents hundreds of dollars. If you do twice, you could go to jail. They race their car, and they don't wear seatbelts. So that's a recipe for disaster. And again, if you're future-oriented, you do just the opposite. So it's true of young children, it's true of college students, it's true of older people. And again, we have much more research, I've only mentioned a little bit. So I'm arguing that time perspective is really a basic foundation of human motivation and value. So if you're past-oriented, we now know you're more happy, you have higher self-esteem, you enjoy rituals. These are the people who are patriotic in every nation. You like nostalgia, you have gratitude, your stability because you know your identity over time. These are the people who have the wisdom of the culture and they have a good sense of identity. The people who are positive in present hedonism, they have affiliation, lots of groups, lots of friends, high joy, take pleasure in life, very sensual, very sexual, lot of energy, and they fill with excitement. And these are the people who are best at improvising. And again, most of us are here, we have high achievement, we have a good health focus, we think in terms of probability, we have a sense of self-efficacy, we could do it. We always do a cost-benefit analysis before we take any action. And we have expectancies, and most important, we have hope. Hope that things could always get better. On the other hand, what's bad about being in the past, you live with trauma, you live with guilt, you live with depression, you live with retaliation, and when you come from a nation where many people have past negative, you never get over the revenge. That in 1762, the Turks did this to us. In 1827, so you continue wanting blood revenge over centuries. Again, as I said, what's worse about being present hedonistic where it's not chosen, it's imposed on you. This is the basis of all addictions. They take risks in life, is high on violence, high on anger, and they believe in gambler's luck. I see all around Poland, little stores where people could go in, little gambling. The only people who go in those places are present-oriented people, okay? And they always lose. The secret in gambling is the house never loses. They let you win once or twice to seduce you in. The house never loses, the business. So future-oriented people know that, they don't go there. What's wrong with us? If you're highly future-oriented, we tend to be anxious, you worry, you work, because you work hard, you isolate yourself, you're very competitive. And I think for men, it's one of the sources of male impotence. Because the sexual act, which should be normal, should be ordinary, birds do it, bees do it, becomes a performance. And if it's a performance, there's performance anxiety associated with it. So for me, the optimal temporal mix is to be positive past, because past gives you roots. It connects you to your identity, to your family, to your culture. It is what is needed to be grounded. What you get from the future is wings to soar to new destinations, to meet new challenges. But what we need from the present is the present gives us energy to explore people, to explore places, to explore yourself, and to explore your sensuality. Now what's exciting, as I mentioned before, there are 24 translations of my scale, including in Polish. There are more than 50 researchers and graduate students and young faculty around the world collecting data. We call it the Z Team. We meet annually at international conferences all over the world. And every single person using the scale is getting significant results. Whether they do bioeconomics or health psychology or business psychology. And we had the first International Congress of Psychology in Coimbra in Portugal last year. And the wonderful news I want to share with you today is in August 2014, we will have International Congress of Psychology in Warsaw. And so we hope that those of you interested will come at the University of Warsaw. This is now an aside. One of the problems that I see of older people everywhere in the Eastern Bloc, having grown up under Nazi Soviet domination, is they developed a time perspective that combines past negative and present fatalism. That is not the stuff of heroism. There are two kinds of heroes. There are impulsive, reactive heroes. There's an emergency, somebody falls on the track, some child is in, they jump in. Those people are present hedonistic. The other kind of hero is reflective, proactive. They see fraud, they see corruption. They have to collect information. They try to get other people to see the way they do. And so those we think of as future-oriented. So to be a hero, and one of my goals is, again, promoting heroes in Polish youth, and also in Nikki Sabice, is how do we help them develop a balanced time perspective, which has some future, some past positive, and some selected present hedonism. So this is the optimal profile. High on past positive, moderately high on future so that you are not a workaholic, and moderate on present hedonism. That is, present hedonism for all of us. When you get something done, you stop. You take time to relax, to enjoy yourself, to see a good movie, to meet with friends, to get a massage, whatever gives you pleasure. But past negative and present fatalism always low. I will talk in a minute at the end of my talk about a new therapy we have developed to deal with people whose whole lives are embedded in being past negative and present fatalistic. So the other problem, barriers in Poland overcoming heroism is that there are many heroes who have challenged unjust external authority. The problem is there's no external enemies anymore for Poland. And so what I learn when I travel around is in Poland, people are creating internal enemies. So the other political party, instead of being adversaries, are beginning to be treated as enemies. And that is not the way to do it. So that, and also, again, a carryover from the Russian domination is the cynical, pessimistic orientation. Heroes are optimistic. Heroes are self-confident. Heroes need to take action, people need to take action to change situation. So the question is, how can we work together to create what we call a national makeover? So last year I wrote a book called The Time Cure, Overcoming Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder, A New Psychology of Time Perspective, and it will be published in Polish in September, and I think I will come back to help my publisher promote it. There are many people in the world who suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder. That simply means an extremely depressive orientation to life that dominates your life. Every hour of the day, you think about, you feel depressed. We see in the media, we see mostly about veterans of war. Now, you don't have many veterans of war recently, but America lately has always been in war, in Vietnam War, Korean War, Iraq War, Afghanistan War. And many of those veterans are coming back after the war, suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder. One negative consequence of post-traumatic stress disorder is people have such difficulty dealing with the pain of depression, they commit suicide. In the last 2 years in America, 650 American veterans coming back home with their family after surviving in the war have committed suicide. That is more soldiers killing themselves than get killed in the war. But also, there's equal number or more of women who have been raped or abused or tortured. The biggest number around the world is fatal automobile accidents. That you have been in an accident where you have killed someone, or you have been in an accident where people in your car have been killed. Why should you care? This highest level of fatal automobile accidents in Europe is in Poland. Okay. So that means to me that there must be many Polish people who, not in war, not in rape, but have been in a fatal automobile accident and survived, who could be or will be suffering from it. Now, the other new thing is natural disasters. Because we have ignored the impending global climate change in every country in the world, we are now about to begin to suffer from natural disasters of the kind we have never seen before. Tornadoes, hurricanes, earthquakes. In New York City, the entire Manhattan was flooded, the subway, for the first time in 1,000 years. At the same time, in the middle of America, it has not rained for 3 years. All of the crops, all the corn, all the wheat is about to stop being produced. So, and what we're seeing is also the oceans are going to be rising 2, 3, 4, 5 inches. That means every country which has a low level, that doesn't have dikes like Holland, will begin to go underwater. This also means all countries that depend on tourism for people to go to their beaches will begin to suffer. And of course, the last category is people who have experienced mass murder shootings. You don't have that in your country. In America, it's a common problem. Common meaning every year or more. There, in school, high schools, colleges, students who have access to weapons kill other people. A recent study looking at young people who had traumatic childhoods of various kinds, a very big study of 17,000 people. They interviewed them and they rated the kind of trauma they had on a scale they call ACE, Adverse Childhood Score. If you had a score of 4, you were 51% more likely to have problems in school, likely to have early sex before you're 15, a boy or girl, but more likely to have cancer, emphysema, mostly from smoking. If you had a higher score, you're 30 times more likely to have committed suicide. What that means is if you have trauma as a child, it can destroy your life. Last year when I was here, there was a report by the Polish Psychiatric Academy that said 1 million Polish school children suffer from clinically level of depression. That is astounding. I don't know if that's true of any country in the world. And so the question is why? There must be many reasons why. I don't know if they followed up to try to understand, but clearly it means something is wrong. Something is wrong in the children's family, something is wrong in the children's school, something is wrong in the children's community. But it means that we as psychologists, clinical psychologists, but psychologists in general, we as educators, we as parents, should be alarmed. Because this other study said, if you grow up with adverse conditions, the consequences for you are devastating. And so now your society says, these children are marked, there's an X on them, saying they are suffering depression already. Okay? And the question is, what can we do about it? And you have to do something. So we see when we test these people, they're high on past negative, low on past positive, high or extremely high or low on present hedonism, high on present fatalism, of course, no future time perspective. 30% of all US veterans suffer from PTSD, and there's no effective treatment. They give them drugs, they give them other things. All the treatment keeps it from getting worse. Nothing makes it better. So what is time therapy? We think it's a breakthrough therapy based on the theory I've been talking about, on time perspective. It's very simple. It focuses on how you can achieve a brighter future, minimizing the negative past, and balancing your time perspective in general. It teaches people simply the importance of time, almost like the lecture I'm giving we give to the patient, how we usually take time for granted, we don't think about time, how we should learn to appreciate the role of time perspective in our lives, in the lives of our family and friends. The therapy was created by this man, Richard Sword, and his wife, Rosemary Sword. They heard me give a lecture, like the one I'm giving you, 4 years ago in Hawaii, and they came up to me afterwards and said, "We think that your ideas we could translate into a simple, effective treatment." I couldn't believe. I said, "Really?" I said, "Well, keep me in touch." And soon they were sending letters to me from veterans saying, "My whole life has been changed in a short time going through this therapy." I said, "Stop. We need to collect data. So we need to give all of your patients a standard psychological test, clinical test, I'll describe in a minute. And then we have to follow them up, you know, every few months." And I say, "What do you do?" He said, "Really, it's really metaphor therapy. We tell them, imagine you, because you have suffered, and we respect the trauma, you have suffered. If you're a soldier, you have killed, you have seen killing. In many cases, they have sometimes raped children. So we know you have experienced something terrible. And the problem is, you have organized your whole life around that terrible experience. But if you're willing to change, we will help you. So really, you have one foot stuck in the mud of the past negative, and the other foot stuck in the mud of present fatalism. It's your choice. If you want to continue that, we cannot help you. You have to go someplace else. But we have a way to get you to take the foot out of the mud, and that foot out of the mud, and put it on the solid soil of the future. Change, possibility, new consequences. And the soil of selected present hedonism. So I won't go through it. We give them a battery of all standard psychological tests, anxiety inventory, depression inventory, and we test them every year for the 4 years. And then we also give our scale. So this is the first results. And I should say, the change we produce happens in, on the average, only 8 sessions. That's rare in any kind of psychotherapy. So what you see is, we test them January 2009, and then June again, and June 2011. The first thing we say is, not one of our 32 vets have attempted suicide. And what you see is, scores on the improvement on depression is 90% immediately, and it persists and actually increases. Same thing with anxiety, same thing with trauma. It dropped a little bit because some of them lost their job. But what we're saying is, we produce an effect immediately in 8 sessions, and the effect lasts at least 3 years that we've been testing. And then when we do, this is a different way to look at it, when we look at percent change, the percent change is enormous on all measures for all these people. And we also give them many resources on the web. And I would love you to visit Life Hut. In Hawaii, they look lifehut.com. And it has meditation exercises, mental stimulation, and it promotes thinking in a balanced way. So I will end with just a few personal accounts. Numbers are impressive if you're a researcher. But here's a few veterans. So this man writes to me, before meeting Dr. Sword, life was not worth living. I was mentally unstable and I saw only the negative in life and negative in people. Self-destructive behavior was the only way I could clear my mind and forget my painful past. Then gaining a positive future time perspective has made my life bearable and possible for me to go on. Due to my changed time perspective, I have hope for a brighter future. The process has completely changed my life. It has made it worth living. So this is a man from Gulf War, older man. Here's a man named Everest, a recent vet from Iraq War. 27-year-old, joined the army when he was only 18. He served in Iraq 13 months. He was a medic. He became a weapons expert. He experienced culture shock when Iraq, reconnected with his uncle and cousin. The problem was, in Iraq, he was with his uncle and cousin, and both of them were killed, and he was the medic who had to treat them when they were blown apart. When he came home, he isolated himself from his loved ones. He experienced nightmares. All the time he's yelling and screaming and then fighting with his wife and family. He was referred to Dr. Sword by his uncle, and he was obviously diagnosed with extreme PTSD. And the key was shifting from present fatalism to present hedonism. And in less than 8 sessions, he has not only been treated, his depression has stopped, he's studying to be a psychiatrist and working with Army Reserves. And so here's his individual profile. And what you can see is when he started in 2007, extremely high on depression, anxiety, and trauma, and over the past 5 years, extremely low, mild or normal on all dimensions. And the same thing with his time perspective score. So here's a woman, interesting case, 21 years old. She began therapy at 17. She had chronic depression, agoraphobia, meaning she could never leave home, and she was cutting herself all the time. The problem was when she was a child, she witnessed her mother being beaten and raped by a former boyfriend, and that when he came in, she would hide in the closet, but she could hear the terrible things happening. When she came in, she had no future orientation. She could not even think about the next minute. She always was flashing back to the good times before the boyfriend came into her life. But she also was, since she was vulnerable, she was a target. She was always bullied at school. By making her more future-oriented and shift her perspective, she was able to confront the bully and stop cutting herself. She moved to another city. She moved near her older sister. And now she has a new future orientation. She has a romantic relationship. She has a job she enjoys. And suddenly she appreciates the characteristics of each person. And here's her scores, even more dramatic than the man. So in the past 4 years, she has gone from extreme severe depression, anxiety, trauma, to mild or normal on every dimension. And what you see is she goes from past negative and present fatalistic to have more future, more present hedonism. So at work, time is the most important thing in the world, but at home, it's really the most precious. And so I argue, as I conclude my presentation, that many of life's puzzles can be solved by understanding your own time perspective. So I urge you to go online so you just identify yourself and make an interesting exercise. Have everybody in your family take the scale, and then it's a great thing to talk about, to discuss. In one way, I'm embarrassed because it's such an obvious idea. It's so simple. So the idea is, how do we think about balanced time? How do we use time wisely and well? But sadly, our time always comes to an end, for better or not, because that's what time does. It begins and ends. But what I say is, we never have enough time, but we have to learn how to make time. To make time what? First for family, make time for friends, make time for lovers, and make time for ourselves. And when we do,
time.
So I would be happy to sign books, sign anything. Polish kisses from beautiful ladies. Take photos.